yeah, we try to balance those out.
It all agrees.
Other Jackson questions?
Quick question on your gym. One WIAA court?
Correct, it would be, if you think of a basketball court, it would be one regulation basketball court.
Is there anything more to it? I mean, that I may be missing?
To the space?
Yeah.
Yeah, so it would be the kind of end lines and side court, right? What you see is the perimeter. We also then have an offset for safety clearance past that. Okay, so there's 7 feet or so on either end of any of those lines. We then have space allocated for the bleachers that we had referenced as well. That room obviously would be, like you see most gyms, would be multi-purpose, so it would be striped to do lots of different things. We'd have multiple basketball hoops. Again, I have a curtain that would divide it in half, so you can run two simultaneous things if you wanted. Not full competition courts, but it would be good for PE or, you know, peewee use or something like that.
How does that compare to what they have now? Is it like 50% bigger?
Yeah, do you remember what the
current one's a postage stamp?
Oh, I know, it's small. I took a tour, but I just wanna, you know.
Hang on a sec, I'll give you the square footage.
Because these are small people, right? It's not high schoolers. High schoolers need a much bigger gym. And I think you're given a proportional gym for this.
Generally, our recommendation would be you start with that as a base. If we hear for budget purposes or clearly that we don't need that, then we can get smaller, certainly. But I think you then limit yourself with the flexibility of using that for alternative uses or park and rec uses. It's difficult to divide it and run two PE classes, right?
How big is the one you're reading?
I'm gonna go here first and then.
Well, you mentioned, you know, the square footage being WIAA. Well, this is an elementary school. We don't even do the competition at elementary school.
No.
I mean, we wanted to have a reasonable size. I get that.
Yeah.
But would we ever really have two PE classes? That would mean two PE teachers. I mean, I don't know that that would be.
I will be the first to say we could go smaller. But it's just generally then you limit your ability to use it for
sure,
that purpose.
Yeah, I understand.
And so we don't start there unless we need to ultimately get there.
I'm not saying that it needs to be smaller, but I'm just saying that I understand, you know, that size for a high school or a middle school, but elementary.
What's really nice is the ability it brings to the community though then too.
Exactly,
you know,
I understand
McLean,
that. Sure.
I know my husband's played basketball in McLean for years.
But McLean is not a WIAA size.
Right, but it's just, you know, it's
yeah. It
opens up to such great opportunities.
Also gives the ability with inclement weather to use it for indoor PE for part of it.
Sure.
So we're not here to say you have to have it by any means. We as a group may decide later down the line that we could do with smaller and cut square footage. Mm-hmm. It's just our best practice to start there. Mm-hmm.
Yep. Pretty sure it was built regulation through summer school there. It allowed did summer school at elementary for years. It allowed those teachers a lot of flexibility to do more activities in a safer way than they did in the past with the smaller gym.
Is their gym the size of?
It's a regulation.
It is? Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, and it was a much safer environment when 30 youngsters are running around.
Sure.
Well, I was just going to say that would give opportunity to cut back on the footprint to give more open space.
There are lots of things we can make smaller. Classrooms can be smaller. The cafeteria we can do with less square footage. I think it's our responsibility at this early phase to provide you what we would recommend as best practices. Mm-hmm. And again, as we roll forward, we'll refine these details.
You know, the other thing that was nice about it, it's not the reason you want to consider having a bigger gym, but even pick up at the end of the day, it allowed me to get kids safer in there and line up safer, so they could go off to the buses then safer.
Yeah.
And it did. When there was bad weather, we could go in there and do activities and stuff like that as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Do you have the proposed classroom sizes?
Right now, a traditional classroom, a first through fourth grade class would be 900 square feet.
So that's what you're planning.
And personally, I feel that we shouldn't sacrifice the size of a classroom because of the learning environment.
Absolutely.
So I think that's a non-negotiable.
And there are, again, many assumptions we have to draw, special ed assumptions. We draw a lot of assumptions about the size of the kitchen. Again, these are without spending all your time going through every one of those. We're just going through what we would recommend you assume has the appropriate size for this building at this point in the process.
Is your cafeteria in the design, is it side by side with your gym, or how?
To be determined, we don't know that.
So is there any way to even get kind of a rough draft?
Of the layout of the building?
Yeah.
Yeah, it would be premature right now, in our opinion, to do a full layout of that building. That doesn't, I don't think, prove if it fits or not, right? I think what we're doing here attempts to go through that exercise. I think it certainly will, any next steps will need to develop that further. But we believe that if the intent is to compare and do a test fit, that this accurately represents that. As soon as we get into design, we really start weaving into academic impact, circulation. It takes many, many meetings with lots of stakeholders to get that design right, okay? And so, again, we'll do that eventually, it's just premature to be going down that path at this point.
I saw something when you were talking about 900 square feet per classroom, and we've used the term best practices a lot. Is best practices, are those standards set by the architectural companies, or are they from the, like, a school district association, a national school district?
Yeah, that's a good question. So, all of the above, okay? So we use guidelines that are set for multiple jurisdictions, so there are a lot of, I would say, standards or recommendations out there. Different states have them. We subscribe to and are part of professional educational design organizations, right? So they have recommendations.
So are those architects for educational design?
No, it certainly are made up of architects, but it's also educators, it's facility managers, it's folks that are certainly in and around the industry. You know, best practices, the reality is that's really evolves, right? So what is the best practice 5, 10 years ago is different today, right? So that's constantly changing. I can speak confidently to working with many, many districts that this, what we're talking about, the types of spaces we're talking about, I think we're reflective of the types of spaces you saw in some of those early presentations. Generally what we hear from communities that they expect their elementary schools.
So best practices can mean the organization or the community that you're designing for, but it can also mean an educational design organization that maybe you belong to that sets standards. I mean, so that term is not really then very static, the term best practice.
It's our recommendation, our professional recommendation, our expertise is in designing schools. And everything that makes up.
But you're saying it's also a community, and a community in North Dakota is going to have very different, rural North Dakota is going to have very different than a community in suburban Chicago, let's say. So how can we know what standards we're looking at?
Absolutely, yeah, and you almost have to trust that we're providing you our best opinion at this point. It's based on those things, certainly it's gut checked against those. We've designed multiple elementary schools, we have multiple on the board right now. None of them are exactly the same, right? None of them have the same goals.
Or the square footage? Square footage, or the fact that you want a classroom a certain size, so maybe you can have tables in the background to work at?
Yep.
You know, I mean, are you still recommending for the same for most school districts?
For certain things, sure. Yeah, I would say, you know, if any school said what's a first grade classroom, how big should that be? It should be 900 square feet. I mean, generally that's gonna meet the goals of the teachers in those classes, the quantity of students that we're teaching. But if that community is a different district that teaches 30 kids a classroom, that might not be, right? They may need more square footage to serve that many kids. And so that changes for every district and group we're working with. The gut check on that would be the assumption there is that every building we design has the same square footage per student, right? So if the best practice is, if it was so uniform, that would be the case, and it's not. Mm-hmm. So every building's different, every district handles things different. We have to respond to the site that we're sitting on, so some buildings are more or less efficient because of the site we're on. Some districts say, we're not going 2 stories, no way, everything's on 1 story. Okay, that's gonna make it a little less efficient.
Sounds like there's a little wiggle room with best practices.
There absolutely is, okay. Yep.
I didn't realize
that. Yep, there absolutely, and nothing's fixed. And again, I think all you've asked us to do is give you a sense of how big should this building be. And based on information that we know about size of enrollment, time spent with staff and leadership, this is our recommendation at this point in the process.
And you're talking about $200 plus square dollars per square foot?
Oh, yeah.
Emphasis on the plus, right.
On the plus, so way over 200 square feet.
As a point of comparison, we were talking about the gym.